Welcome to the Vision Quest video series, a step-by-step guide to holistic health. This series is comprised of 40 programs, each addressing a specialized area of holistic healing. Roger Yanke, doctor of traditional Chinese medicine. And my background is that I always wanted to be a doctor since I was a little child, since my father passed away when I was quite young. And in college, I went to pre-med and got a job in a hospital and everything, and I realized very quickly that that was not what I thought medicine was going to be or should be. And therefore, I became a student of the world's original culture's literature systems, I guess you would call it, the poetry, the dramas, etc. And interestingly enough, in primitive cultures, I found the kind of ideals of healing that I thought had maybe been lost here in the Western world. So I pursued traditional Chinese medicine, been to China 5 times, really amazing experience. China, very far away, philosophically as well as in miles. And I have had the wonderful privilege of being the director of a clinic for many years and being a consultant for numerous hospitals and HMOs, as there is a very fortunate turn occurring in the healthcare industry.
Tai Chi is one of China's most popular forms of self-healing practice. Sometimes called moving meditation, Tai Chi is a method for balancing internal life force, the Qi, for self-healing, resolving emotions, and cultivating the spirit.
Tai-Chi Chaun is an ancient branch of Chinese traditional sports of wushu or martial arts, which has been recently revised into a means of keeping fit and preventing disease. The art of Tai-Chi Chaun, usually shortened to Tai-Chi and previously known as shadow boxing, means wholeness and is based on a series of slow-moving circular movements best performed outside.
The new Tai-Chi is actually China called Tai-Chi Chaun. It's spring ultimate boxing. It's the finest product of Chinese philosophy and culture for health, relaxation, self-defense, and self-cultivation. It's an exercise system to work on the mind, body, breath, working together.
Tai Chi means unity, means oneness, wholeness, balance with the universe. In actual fact, this symbol, I don't know if you can see, this symbol in the center, the circle, is called Tai Chi because it means unity. The balance of the two major cosmic forces.
Tai Chi aims to allow an individual to develop focus mentally, physically, and emotionally. This ancient Chinese meditative practice is perhaps the most complete and natural of all holistic therapies. Tai Chi is a highly complex practice involving discipline, patience, and perseverance, and should not be looked upon as merely a means of working out the physical body.
Now, just to clarify something, Tai Chi, as it's pronounced in the Western world, is actually not correct. It's Tai Chi Chuan. That's a different word to Qi energy. It's a different character, it's a different pronunciation. It's often spelt the same in the West, but even that is not correct. Qi energy is the life force of all living things. And as human beings, we have a wonderful capacity that we can utilize this Qi energy in ways that other living things don't have an opportunity to do, because we can learn and practice Qi exercises that stimulate the flow of the Qi energy in our body, that help to actually generate, to make more qi in our system so we can contain more qi. Qi is something that when a person dies, the qi is no longer in the body. The body may still be there, you see the body, but the life has gone out of it. We call that the qi.
Tai Chi Chuan is one of the traditional wuxi of China and was first devised by Chen Jai Gao, Wenxian County in Henan Province, about 400 years ago in the late Ming Dynasty. According to ancient Chinese legends, the beginnings of Tai Chi Chuan can be traced back to the Taoist thinker named Chan Sang Feng. San Feng was concerned about the aggressive nature of martial arts and aimed to develop a soft approach to spiritual development. One day, while watching a magpie pecking a snake, San Feng noticed how the snake moved slowly and continuously as it tried to evade its attacker. The snake's neat circular movements and yielding quality impressed San Feng, who incorporated this form of movement into his own style of chuan, or fist exercise. Fan Seng's style incorporated the characteristics of numerous animal movements developed by Taoist physicians such as Hao To in the 3rd century AD. These included the tiger, the symbol of the ego, which had to be ridden or mastered, the monkey, which had to be resisted, as well as the bear, the crane, and others. In approximately 1400 AD, the more advanced form of this chuan was developed and acquired the name Tai Chi Chuan, meaning supreme ultimate fist. This new form of chuan was aimed at mastery of the whole self and was adopted by Taoist monks in their monasteries as a way of integrating the body, mind and spirit by combining movement with breath. The monks found that by performing these movements, their minds and bodies will become more focused. Tai Chi was then gradually transformed into a meditative healing process. Tai Chi was first performed for the public in the mid-19th century, and today millions of Chinese practice this exercise in the early mornings and early evenings in parks and outer spaces each day. The philosophy of Tai Chi is based on the belief that, following an emotional and or mental disturbance, illness occurs from imbalances in the body's energy known as qi, moving either too slowly or too quickly in the body, or from too much qi developing in one area. Tai Chi is largely based on achieving a balance between two complementary energies known as yin and yang. In Chinese philosophy, the yin force is a gentle female force, while the yang is the firm, active and creative male force. By balancing both these forces, harmony and balance is said to occur, and illness or disease is said to be suppressed.
Well, there are a number of different philosophies, and they were predominantly in those days, and we're talking thousands of years ago, were performed by the monks who lived and worked in, or lived in monasteries, and I guess they worked. And the original idea was that the monks sitting in meditation for hours and hours on end became very lethargic and had great difficulty in maintaining a centeredness. And so the movements were designed to help generate a balance within their body that simultaneously created a harmony in their mind. And the original movements were similar but also quite different to what we see today, but the original philosophy still is prevalent in the various different forms. So it was to help them to remain fit and healthy and to maintain their ability to concentrate in meditation. An extension of that became their need as travellers throughout the countryside to be able to defend themselves. And so the movements became designed around doing things that help to ward off attack. And whilst the way I practice Tai Chi is more for internal health, the constant repetition of certain movements means that if one day somebody comes to attack me, hopefully my instant reactions will be to raise my arm to block in some way or to turn in a particular way that their energy flows past me and doesn't actually connect with me.
Philosophy behind Tai Chi basically is yin-yang balance. Talk about strong and soft, high and low, and how to make them balance. For example, if something hard towards you and using soft to overcome it, this is basic philosophy. And also the philosophy of Taoism, which is the founder called Lao Tzu. And he advocates natural efforts, not much on the physical, but more on mental focus.
During Tai Chi practice, 10 essentials are usually performed, which include straightening of the head, correct positioning of the chest and back, relaxation of the waist, a solid and empty stance, a sinking of the shoulders and elbows, the use of the mind instead of physical exertion, coordination of the upper and lower parts, balance between the internal and external body, the continuity of movements, and the tranquility within each movement.
Different times of day, the energy flow in the universe varies. Traditionally, the times of day that are said to be best for drawing in the energy, which is one of the things that you're doing with Tai Chi, are sunrise or sunset. Now, sunrise is a time when the energy of the universe or the external environment is changing from yin to yang. And it's a positive time of day to draw in an inner strength, a strengthening of the energy. The yang is active and it is energy, whereas yin is more associated with nourishment and centeredness, balance. So at the closing of the day, at sunset, if you were to do Tai Chi at that time, the types of energies that you would be drawing into yourself and being connected with are going to be more closely associated with the yin energies, the yang moving into the yin. I personally don't like to do Tai Chi during the heat of the day, during, you know, like the middle of the day, because of the heat. It's quite, especially here, it's quite intense. And I also prefer to do it in the morning because it seems for me to give a different flavour to my day. When I'm able to do my Tai Chi first thing in the morning, it's like my day generally flows smoothly. I'm more centred, my thinking is clearer. And if I do that at night, maybe I will have a better sleep, but it's more useful for me to have clear thinking and so forth during the day. The major styles are categorised according to names of people who invented them. Yang style is a very common style. Wu style, so Mr. Yang and Mr. Wu both developed styles. Yang style is prevalent more in northern China, I believe, and Wu style you see more around the southern parts of China, especially around areas like Shanghai. Then there is Chen style. I can't even think of all of the different traditional names, but I mean, I know other styles which are known as spiritual Tai Chi, supreme Tai Chi, who they don't actually have individuals' names attached to them.
And how are they different in their approaches?
Spiritual Tai Chi? They're different in that they focus somewhat more, I guess, on the healing notion and the meditational aspect rather than developing a strong stance so that you can help to ward off an attack. To my knowledge, Yang style is considered one of the best for developing what we call a strong stance, so a good strength in the legs, which is an important part of good practice of Tai Chi, because it helps to actually generate the energy in the body that motivates the movement within. It's also extremely important for good health and longevity.
best you can see is for reduce the stress and anxiety. Because when you're doing Tai Chi, you are focus your mind, body into the movement. You will forget your all worries. And because it's a deeper on breathing, bring the circulation, the oxygen in the body. Apart from here, you're going to develop a very good body posture because you need, you can see spine straight, leg down, shoulder relax. It's good for the body posture. And while you're doing Tai Chi, always turning left to right, and that will be very good for the exercise internal organs rather than physical body itself. And of course, when you're doing Tai Chi, also we call the moving meditation. It's very good for cleansing the mind, make you can easily focus on what you are doing.
Yeah, Tai Chi is, when it's done properly, when it's taught properly and people are able to pick it up well, Tai Chi is quite notorious for bringing things up in people, and I've had people in classes that have started to get quite angry in the class, and other people who become quite emotional. And sometimes it's not during the class, sometimes it can be after, because in a class situation, of course, energy is concentrated when there's a number of people doing something together. So it does have a tendency to create a surge. But because the nature of the exercises is to activate the flow of movement through the pathways or the meridians in the body, then and emotions have a tendency to create blockage. So if there is something, if your energy becomes quite strong and pushes a blockage, then it's quite likely, in order to release it, you experience the old emotion.
And that can be, I wouldn't really see that as a negative
effect. Oh no, not at all. It's a very positive effect. I think that I have known of people who have been in classes where the teachers perhaps have not been familiar enough with the healing process associated with this whole philosophy and have been very defensive around what's actually going on for people, especially when somebody gets angry. I mean, I have been in class situations where, not my own class, but with my teacher, where people get very angry and they want to verbally attack him. And he just smiles and allows them to release and doesn't buy into their drama, if you like, but also doesn't suppress it, doesn't try and make them stop. Just lets them go, lets the energy come out, and in time it passes. But other people can feel like they're being attacked and become defensive, and that, of course, is counterproductive. Is just recently I had an entertainer come to me for a treatment, and she's a sort of a singer, a dancer, and I gave her a qigong massage, and afterwards she said, oh, you know, how often do you go to the gym? Do you work out with weights? And when I said to her I've never been to a gym, she really was quite surprised, like, how do you do that? And whilst I also do qigong exercises, for 20 years I have simply been doing Tai Chi Chuan and qigong. In my 20s, I also did a lot of kung fu. I haven't done that much kung fu in recent years. But certainly the nature of these exercises is that it works the internal energy. They're called internal exercises in Chinese. And that means that they strengthen the energy, they strengthen the functioning of our internal organs. They don't necessarily build big muscles, but they certainly build strong muscles. So and not only that, they also build health. They are for maintaining health and for developing longevity. When you've been practicing a form or a set for long enough, it's second nature. It's like walking. You don't think about, oh, what do I have to do next? What is my next hand movement? Where does my foot go? You just stand there and you begin Tai Chi. Immediately you go into a meditative state. In that state, there are many things that you can do. What I personally do with Tai Chi is just allow thoughts to come and go, to come and go. I don't focus on anything in particular other than my breathing and the exchange of energy between myself and the environment. So I'm concentrating on just harmonizing with my environment by, as I breathe in, I'm taking the energy in. As I breathe out, I'm just making an exchange with the trees, the water, whatever around me. And that is my meditation. Interestingly, if I have a problem or something that I need to make a decision about and I haven't been able to think about it, often the answer just comes to me in the midst of doing my Tai Chi, which is another, it's like in, you know, when you sit in meditation and you ask for information to be given, it's the same kind of thing.
Basically speaking, they are almost the same. They also are slow and meditative, but Tai Chi do have some martial arts within the movements. But Qigong is purely on healing, get energy. Put in one word, Qigong is one to achieve calm outside, but activate inside circulation. But in Tai Chi is activating outside, but remain calm inside. So it's a little different there.
To my awareness, I in fact call Tai Chi a form of Qigong. It's a very complex and long form of Qigong. Qigong really just means something that a person does, in this instance an exercise or a body movement that is coordinated with movement and breath. And that is what Tai Chi is. But Qigong tends to isolate movements or take separate individual movements and repeat them for a particular purpose, for a particular individual or a number of specific purposes. There are many different forms of Qigong also. But with Tai Chi, a complete set of Tai Chi will take a person through many, many different states, energy states and mental emotional states within themselves in the course of practicing one set. Tai Chi takes much longer. It requires generally more space than Qigong. Qigong can be done in a very small space generally. But ultimately, I feel that they are they're so interconnected that it's very hard for me to differentiate clearly between the two. Whilst the actual process is totally different, the end results ostensibly are the same. So it's my feeling, I've never really gone into the Indian yoga traditions, but what I've read, what I've heard of other people, yes, it's the same thing. It's just you get there in a different manner. I think that its introduction into Western society was known as shadow boxing, and our notion of that is sort of an aggressive sort of thing associated with defending yourself. But in 20 years of practicing Tai Chi, I have never done it or used it as a form of self-defense. My teacher didn't teach it in that way. My teacher is a healer, as I am, and we look more at the internal aspects of what Tai Chi Chuan can do for the individual. So the five movements that I have done in this instance happen to be the first five movements of this particular set. And what's important about them is that they are repeated many times throughout a complete set. Most forms of Tai Chi will have several, if not all, of these movements in them at some point, not necessarily in this particular order. So we will begin with the opening. You start with your feet being shoulder width apart and parallel. Your body is erect, the head upright as if it's been suspended from above. You breathe in and bend the waist forward. In doing so, just let the arms relax. Standing with your feet shoulder width apart, feet parallel, head erect, body straight and relaxed. Breathe in, and as you breathe out, bend the waist forward. Let the shoulders relax and the arms drop forward. Breathing out. Slowly standing up, you breathe in, raising the arms up to shoulder height, drawing in the elbows, breathing in, bending the knees and pressing down as you breathe out. Shifting the weight onto the left leg so that you take your entire body's weight balanced on the left leg, raise the right heel. Step out with the right foot, looking to the right, raising the arm. Looking to the left, raising the left arm, and then bringing them together in front of your chest, the palms facing one another. Move the weight forward onto the right foot, raising the left heel, and then let the body turn to the left. Holding the ball movement, moving your weight onto the right leg, let the right hand drop down in a circle and then around, the left hand coming underneath, holding a ball. The fourth movement is grasping the bird's tail. From holding the ball, the left leg steps out slightly and you move forward, bringing the left hand up as if to block, exchanging the two hands and moving back. Grasping the bird's tail, moving the hands to the right. Bringing the hands in front of the chest, turning to the front, moving forward, again as if to block. Right hand slips over the left, open the hands. Move back, shifting your weight back onto the right leg. Turn the palms out as if to push. And move the body forward, then move the hands. Fifth movement is called single whip. From that position, move back, drawing the energy in towards you and turn, turning on the left heel all the way to the right. The left hand forms a hook. The right hand scoops down and comes up to touch the wrist of the left hand. Turn the body, raising the right heel to the right. Turn the right hand and step out as if to make a block. Adjust the left foot. Single whip. Next movement is called slanting flying posture. Left leg steps across in front of the right. Right hand below the left elbow across the body. Right leg steps out and put your weight on the right leg, slanting the body, drawing the right hand up, the left hand down.
All right, today in a short time, I just want to show the audience the most aspect of Tai Chi. First, I'm doing just a warm-up. I try to particularly emphasize my breathing and physical little stretch to make me focus better and prepare a little bit, loosening up all the joints. And then I did called the Tai Chi Qigong in 18 movements. In China we call the 18 shi. It's a group of exercise, a combination of Qigong and Tai Chi together in 18 movements. It's good for to mastering the coordination of the body and use visualization with the mind and also the breathing deeper too. It's good fundamental training for to mastering Tai Chi. And then I show you a part of Tai Chi Yang style. This is the most popular form nowadays because easy flow. What I did now is called the international standardized Yang style Tai Chi, because nowadays China, to make all the Tai Chi form into standardized for every country people to learn, and nowadays even have international competitions for Tai Chi. So it's Yang style. I do only half of it. Then I did a Yang style Tai Chi sword. So this is after you mastering your body with Tai Chi, now you're going to mastering something beyond your body. Now it's a sword. And the sword is a symbol of strength in the Chinese culture. Also sword is a martial arts weapon. You learn the techniques. So now using Tai Chi principle with the body and mastering the mind to let energy, qi energy control the body, body leads the sword. And it's a little bit advanced to learn. The last section I did is only first section on traditional Qin style Tai Chi. As I said, Qin style is the oldest form in Tai Chi. It, you can see the vigorous part of Tai Chi, also general part of Tai Chi. It's the oldest form, and this form contains about 83 movements. But I show the first section, you can see much lower stance, and I particularly have this spiral energy force. Sometimes exposure of strength, sometimes in piece like a little leg, piece of leg. So it's good for yin yang dynamic and also the feeling expression. So it's a little bit advanced to learn, but it's good to learn. Anybody can give a go. Oh, important is after you're doing Tai Chi, you're creating a lot of energy in your body. Now, when you're closing, we say it's returned energy to the source. Where is the source in the body? Regarding something, area around your navel, we call the dantian, or the energy field. You let energy return to the dantian, and which means you save all the energy you created and for your everyday life to use. So important.
Numerous medical studies have been conducted in China on individuals who practice Tai Chi over long periods and have found that many report the following benefits: increase in body awareness, health, balance, confidence, reduction of anxiety, reduced stress, and increase in physical tone.
Well, I think at the moment, I mean, I know some doctors who are very aware of the overall benefits for people practicing things like Tai Chi Chuan. In general, I think that doctors these days will say, oh, well, it's not going to do you any harm. In fact, this is what I have heard people say to me. Oh, well, I told my doctor I wanted to do that, and he said, well, it may not do you any good, but it won't do you any harm. And that's just out of ignorance, really, and I'm not saying that derogatorily. If a person doesn't know something about something, then if they've got a bit of an idea, well, I'll think, well, it's certainly, yeah, it's not going to be harmful. In the future, I mean, in China, it's, I mean, we could take a leaf out of their book in looking at what they do. They use Tai Chi to help maintain the strength and the health of the population, sort of in an almost en masse. Not to say that the people don't get sick or have illnesses, they certainly do. But they are encouraged to practice their various different forms of energy generating exercises in order to move beyond the illness. Because it comes down to the way Chinese medicine understands the body, and the qi, the life force, is the most important thing. And as yet, Western medical science has yet to discover that, if you like, they because it can't be seen.
First, I'm not that easy upset, because I know if somebody upset to you, if you upset back, it's because the fire towards fire. I have to use it, okay, you're fire, I'm water, I'm easy, right? Now, every time you do, you know, take easy, because it's no rush to do things. Everything have their own pace. So take easy, and for me, I feel like enjoying more, I can see more things, and learn more things, listen more things, like that.
When I first started learning Tai Chi, I was a very inward-oriented person. I wouldn't say boo to anybody. To think of sitting in front of a camera and talking to somebody would have been my greatest nightmare. To stand up in front of a group of people and say anything was also a bit of a nightmare for me. I had a great lot of difficulty expressing and putting my energy out. But through practicing Tai Chi, I developed an inner strength. So one day when my teacher said, Sally, will you come out here and demonstrate that move that we've just done? At first, my knees went quivery and I thought, oh no, not me. But I went out there and to my amazement, I did it. I didn't freeze, I didn't freak out. And from then on, he actually encouraged me to come and stand in front of the class more often. And what I discovered was that through the process of practicing these exercises, I developed a connection with my true self, my inner self, if you like. And I found that person was really quite competent and capable, whereas in the past, I didn't think I was really that good at anything very much. And I've seen that happen with a number of different people over the years in different ways. I mean, I, of course, express that in workshops that I give now, in talking to people individually and in groups. And I see, you know, other people. I know an actor who uses Tai Chi as much as anything for centering. And I'm sure that there is a part of what you get with the Tai Chi that allows you to be able to give out. To truly get the sense of it, when you have a very good teacher, I really believe, whilst people will offer shorter than this, I really believe that you should look at least a year, if not longer, considering yourself as a beginner. And that means going to classes virtually every week, if not more than once a week, and practicing what you learn every day. Because learning the movements isn't understanding or learning Tai Chi. Anybody can learn the movements. What Tai Chi is the constant repetition and practice and the build-up of qi that generates in your body. And that only happens over time. And, I mean, for myself, I think it took me 3 years of going to classes before I really had a strong sense of the qi that I could feel the qi, but I wasn't always able to tap into the benefits of it. Once I started to feel that, after, say, 3 years, I could then find that year by year, my development has increased and changed, and I have become more centered, more calm, more strong, more healthy. And so as years go by, I anticipate that becoming just continuing, so that I would not call myself a master by any stretch of the imagination, but I know many people who have been practicing Tai Chi for a shorter period of time consider themselves masters because perhaps they understand the movements and their martial applications, but I often wonder, have they really got the feeling? Have they really got the energy? Have they actually made that connection? I mean, in 20 years, I think I have probably learned maybe 10 different forms of Tai Chi. And after some years, I realized that I was never going to remember all of them, and that there was no point in trying to practice all of them to keep a knowledge of them all, that I needed to choose one that really resonated with me and just continue on focusing on that and to continue practicing that, because the essence of these things is, as I said before, repeating something until it's such second nature with you that you don't think about it. And when you don't think about it, your actions are reflexive. As if you're going to walk across the room, you don't think, oh, walk across the room, I'll move my right leg, I'll move my left leg. You just, once you learn how to walk, you just think walk and you go. Or you don't even think walk, you just think I'm going over there. The same with doing the Tai Chi. So the set that I chose happened to be the one which my teacher choreographed, and he took the best aspects of Yang's, or what he considered the best aspects of Yang style and Wu style, and included aspects of another form called Bagua, and put them together, and that's what was created. And I really enjoy doing that. Well, I would certainly investigate many different people who are teaching and just find out about their background. The best thing to do is to go to a number of different classes and get a feeling for the individual. Because whilst a person can be a very, very good teacher, if you don't have a rapport with them, or if their energy somehow and your energies don't mix, then you're never going to learn effectively. There are a lot of people teaching Tai Chi, and whilst I won't say that they're not good, there's just a whole different variety. You really need to be very careful about the background of the person, what they are actually teaching. When people talk to me, because at this present time, I haven't been teaching Tai Chi, and when people who come to see me want to learn, I just encourage them to go to a class near to where they live, a beginner's class, get a basic feel for the movement. Any beginner's class is going to be better than none. Once a person gets an idea and a feel for what Tai Chi is, they usually then they'll go out and they'll read books and they'll get videos. Check out as many different ones as you can, and what you'll start to find is that you will get a feeling for one of them and go with that.
Oh, I can see the huge influence in the future, because now we know our lifestyle is so competitive, so stressful, and Tai Chi will become we call the natural tranquilizer. No side effect, no too much money, finance are involved, and for self to balancing harmony between your physical and mental, and that way we can survive in such a busy world.
Well, I see it just continuing to develop the way it has. As I said, 20 years ago, I was considered a bit of a weirdo and a freak going off doing these strange, slow movements in the park. But now people walk up to me when I've finished and say, oh, you're doing Tai Chi. It's become common knowledge. And I believe that in the future, it will become more and more a part of a Western way of maintaining health, if not maintaining emotional harmony and balance as well.
Over the past four centuries, the popularity of Tai Chi Chuan has increased and spread far beyond China's borders to Southeast Asia, Japan, Europe, the Pacific, and the Americas. This is an indication of its immense value in increasing one's health, self-awareness, and well-being. Tai Chi Chuan is an exercise which, when performed regularly, may help keep one fit, prevent illness, slow down the rate of growing old, and prolong a healthy and long life.